I am a Kashmiri Hindu living in exile. You must have heard about Kashmiri Hindus on TV channels, read about us in newspapers, and maybe even made friends with one of us in your college or workplace. You probably empathize with us, but how much do you know about us? If recounting what we went through does not send shivers down your spine, or impel you to safeguard yourself from the menace of Abrahamic religious intolerance, well, you just don't know enough. If we go by written history, Kashmiri Hindus are the aborigines of Kashmir, the native pagans who survived centuries of cruel oppression just to keep the flag of Indian civilization fluttering in the valley against all odds. From the 14th century to the present times, the Hindus of Kashmir have been at the literal bleeding edge of this clash of civilizations. As a result, over the course of a few centuries, most Kashmiris have been converted out of the Hindu fold by force, intimidation, and brutal violence that characterized the better part of Muslim rule in Kashmir. Some people ask why all Kashmiri Hindus belong to just the Brahmin caste. Well, that's because all other castes were converted by the swords of tyrants who ruled the valley. Tyrants like Sikandar Butshikan, Ali Shah, Shamsuddin Iraqi, and others not only carried out terrible genocides, but also destroyed the centers of Kashmiri spiritual and intellectual life, the great temples like the Sun Temple at Marthand, and countless other shrines. Kashmiri women are beautiful. There was a time in the valley, under Afghan rule, when their striking looks became such a burden on their families that their noses had to be cut off and their heads shaved to protect the Hindu girls from the lustful eyes of the ruling barbarians. All this created pressure on the dwindling Hindu community to flee from the valley. Not once or twice, but seven times since Islam came to Kashmir. With 1990 being the final blow when Kashmir was finally free of any significant Hindu presence and influence. This final blow took the valley to the brink of severing its last ties with the Indian civilization. But there was a qualitative difference between this and the earlier exoduses. That is, the involvement of common citizens in the act of terrorizing the non-believers. Indeed, while the terrorist outfits were funded and propped up by Pakistan, it was the local Kashmiris who enthusiastically filled their ranks and provided crucial logistical and moral support to the Mujahideen. As a result, it was common in the late 80s and early 90s for Hindu men to find their Muslim neighbors and friends for decades turning hostile overnight, to the extent of shooting them dead and raping their women. Take for example the killing of Neelkant Raina, a teacher who was killed by his own students in cold blood while his neighbors assisted the killers in quickly escaping from the crime scene. The murder was meticulously planned and skillfully executed. It was a demonstration of superlative teamwork by his students and neighbors, who had probably been taught the virtues of collaboration by the veteran teacher himself. Girja Kumari Tikku was a laboratory assistant at a government high school. She had already left the valley along with other Hindus in early 1990 and was living in a refugee settlement in the Jammu province. She went back to the valley for a few days to collect her dues from the school, never to return. On her way to the school, she was kidnapped, gang-raped and sodomized before being cut into two pieces on a sawmill. She was survived by a 4-year-old son and a 2-year-old daughter. Professor K.L. Ganju and his wife, Mrs. Prana Ganju, were kidnapped along with their nephew. After showering bullets on the professor, his dead body was quickly disposed of into the turbulent waters of the Jhelum. Like in the movies, his nephew was given a choice to jump into the river or watch his aunt's modesty getting outraged, of which he took the first choice and survived. Mrs. Ganju? She was gang-raped, her breasts chopped off before she was killed. Just as the dust of Hindu eviction from the valley was settling, it dawned upon the terrorist leadership of the valley and their apologists in the media all over the world that the public perception of the secessionist movement was getting damaged. So a narrative began to be promoted that the then governor of Jammu and Kashmir, Jagmohan, had conspired to get the Hindus evicted so that the Indian security forces may freely oppress the Muslim population. The religious terrorism of Kashmiris underwent a cosmetic surgery and began to be called a political struggle. Always remember, Kashmir is a religious and civilizational conflict. It has no political dimension except on the surface. Now, there are hundreds of gruesome cases of terror and betrayal to narrate, but I chose Neelkanth Raina, Girja Tikku and the Ganju couple to drive home an important point. All of them were killed after the Hindu community had already left. Jagmohan was no longer the governor. He had been recalled by the Home Minister Mufti Sayyid in May 1990 itself. These atrocities were thus a signal from the majority community to the exiled Hindus never to even think of returning to their homeland. Their houses had been occupied, their places were being renamed, Kashmir was no longer theirs. It's been nearly three decades now. Kashmiri Hindu is a dying identity. The trauma of several centuries and the terror we have witnessed under the watch of the democratic Indian state has snatched away a sense of belonging and meaning from us. We remain unacknowledged victims of terror, often blamed for being victims of terror. Some of us suffer from the Stockholm syndrome. We've been used by political parties across the spectrum for petty electoral benefits and mocked by ignorant fellow Indians for not resisting the armed terrorists. Yet, we are the proud inheritors of a glorious culture that has been systematically destroyed over several centuries. Ultimately, we are a reminder of what may happen to you if you continue to live in denial. So what do Kashmiri Hindus want from fellow Indians? Number one, learn from our experience and give up the illusion that the government, the judiciary, their holy book, the constitution, or one of those human rights cottage industry NGOs will come to your rescue in adverse circumstances. Your family's safety is first and foremost your business. Number two, don't fall for terrorist propaganda and understand that giving up Kashmir is not an option for India. Number three, Kashmir is as much yours as it is ours. Now that the Articles 35A and 370 have been made inoperative, it is important that the step is taken to its logical conclusion, which is to alter the demographic composition of the state to neutralize the extremist mindset that has taken hold of the people of the valley. Number four, most importantly, help Kashmiri Hindus politically. Don't forget that only the legal status of the state has changed. The conditions that led to the eviction of Kashmiri Hindus remain. Don't expect Kashmiri Hindus to go back to the same conditions to get slaughtered. Build pressure on the government to come out with a roadmap for resettlement of all Hindus, not just Kashmiri Hindus in the valley. Kashmir is the crown of the Indic civilization. It is a kshetram that has blessed us with spiritual, intellectual and cultural marvels. It is the fountainhead of Bharat's creative genius. Reclaim Kashmir to reclaim your own self. This is Ashish Dhar for Upward.